just this hour, the deteriorating situation in northern Syria, where Turkey is intensifying its offensive against the Syrian Kurds. U.S. President Donald Trump has now ordered the withdrawal of all remaining U.S. troops inside northern Syria, concerned that they'll be caught between two opposing advancing armies. That order comes as Turkish forces push further south into Syria. In fact, Turkey's leader says the offensive will go about 30 to 35 kilometers into Syrian territory. Pro-Turkish forces have already taken over a strategic highway in Syria, which has effectively cut off the Kurdish city of Kobani. All this as Syria's state news agency says units from the Syrian army are moving north to confront Turkey's offensive. Our correspondents are tackling developments right across the globe. Pentagon correspondent Barbara Starr is in Washington. Our Awa Damon is near the Turkish-Syrian border. But we begin with our Nick Payton Walsh, who has been close to the fighting in northern Syria.
The road to Kobani tells you how savage this war already is and where it's going. Here, Kurdish female activist Harlevin Khalaf was shot dead, allegedly by Syrian rebels Turkey's backing. A gruesome video of the killing viral online. Just outside Ain Issa and its huge ISIS family camp, there is panic.
And guys, body armors.
Gunfire up ahead. Trucks turn around fast. Families in disarray. There are heavy clashes there, he says. Nobody can go. What do you want from us, hey? He says. They're coming and they'll take everything. May God end America. Turkey and before them ISIS have been their enemies here, but only America betrayed them. And they are leaving. Just down the road, there's patrol pulling out of Ain Issa.
Well, they don't want to talk to us, but clearly Americans still active in areas around the Syrian Kurds.
As they leave, Turkey makes its bold ambition to go anywhere here felt.
Jet.
A jet flying low. Sending a message to us, the Kurds and the Americans, leave now. But the arrival of two US Apache helicopters to circle the area and their patrol show the Americans are not ready to do that just yet, despite President Trump's instincts to end the endless wars, as he says. Syria's war, though, just keeps getting longer.
Well, a US official has told me that actually the road now towards Kobani, where they have some of their troops based, has been cut off by Turkish-backed Syrian rebels. They set up checkpoints just outside that town we were in. We've had to leave, but this is extraordinary. Nobody thought this was originally part of Turkey's invasion plan.
And as we drive away, it seems clear Turkey plans to seize the road in part. These are Turkish armored personnel carriers and tanks bearing Turkish flags, more of them arriving in the dust. Soon, Syrian Kurds won't be able to drive down here at all. And the west of their area cut off from its east. The city of Kobani, again, left to face a siege. Nick Payton Walsh, CNN, Ain Issa, northeastern Syria.
Well, joining me now from Washington with his perspective is David Senger, CNN political and national security analyst. Good to have you with us, David, to give us some perspective on all of this. Obviously, the key development today, we're hearing that the U.S. is withdrawing all the remaining troops from Syria, some 1,000 troops. What does that mean? Is this the end of the U.S. in Syria?
Well, it is, looks like it's pretty close to the end of the U.S. in Syria. What it certainly does is undo the work of the past 5 years. And what's particularly remarkable about it is that it was just on Friday that we had State Department and Pentagon spokespeople saying, oh, this only involved the withdrawal of 40 or 50 troops, those that were immediately withdrawn from the after the president's conversation with President Erdogan last weekend, and that, you know, the main U.S. force inside Syria remains. Well, 48 hours later, they are announced to be beating a retreat for that group as well. It's another example of this administration's inability to see around the corner of what would be the result of the president's decision.
Exactly. You make a really good point there. We did hear from the Kurds in Syria, in particular the commander of the Kurdish forces, through our Pentagon team, who said they see the US withdrawal as worse than betrayal, that they claim that they've been left to be slaughtered. What's the likelihood, if there is a resurgence of ISIS in Syria, that the Kurds would ever help the US again?
Oh, pretty small that they ever would. And you know, that's the risk here, that the president has conflated a justifiable concern about endless war, a concern that Barack Obama had as well. He's conflated that with keeping a small force present that's supposed to both conduct intelligence and do enough operations to keep you from having to come in a bigger way. And obviously, if ISIS did reclaim territory, if it did come back, that would force a U.S. decision about whether to go back in, but as you point out, this time without allies.
And as he says he wants to withdraw these troops in Syria, he's sending more troops into Saudi Arabia. How does that make sense, that he's wanting to withdraw troops from one area of that region and send in more elsewhere?
No, it really is remarkable. And we went a few rounds at this with at the State Department during a presentation they had the other day with Brian Hook, the U.S. Special Representative for Iran, asking the question, how could you justify putting forces into Saudi Arabia to counter Iran while basically doing Iran and Russia a huge favor in Syria by pulling troops out? And as Mr. Hook was being pressed on this more and more, the State Department spokeswoman just ended the session. And the reason that she did so was it's a very hard question for this administration to answer. And the only answer must be that the Saudis have a particular hold on the president's allegiances that clearly he doesn't have as he tries to think about the mission in Syria.
David Singer, if you can just stand by for us, I want to bring in our Barbara Starr from the Pentagon, who's been reporting on this for the last few days. Barbara, I want to first ask you about the 1,000 troops that the president now wants to withdraw from Syria, pulling out every single member of the U.S. there. Just explain how soon that could happen for us and how the U.S. will ensure that they are pulled out safely.
Well, this may be a very difficult situation. For now, the military is saying it wants to withdraw in a very orderly and deliberate manner, that it could take days or weeks, but it's not at all clear they have days or weeks to do it because the security situation in northern Syria is really deteriorating by the hour. So what we do know is tonight, as we stand here in Washington, there are armed U.S. aircraft overhead wherever there are U.S. troops in northern Syria, over every position. They are patrolling the skies, watching for any trouble, ready to defend U.S. troops if it comes to that. The plan would be to get them out by air and by ground vehicles. That's very well known. But with the security situation deteriorating, with highways being cut by fighters on the ground, with communications being cut through certain areas, whether the U.S. can really wait for this orderly withdrawal may remain to be seen. If they cannot, it becomes a very extreme situation, and they will have to think about whether they can take the time to pack up and get all their weapons and classified equipment out of there, or whether some of this material may have to be destroyed in place before they go. Linda?
Barbara, thanks so much. I just want to play some sound from Donald Trump, because he appears unfazed by the bloodshed in northern Syria. And I want to come back to you on this, David Sanger. Let's take a listen to what Donald Trump has had to say.
I don't think our soldiers should be there for the next 50 years guarding a border between Turkey and Syria when we can't guard our own borders at home. I don't think so.
In light of this, David, the Kurds have threatened to cut a deal with Russia. Should the U.S. be worried about that?
Well, if you're ceding Syria to Russia, I think that's something to be concerned about strategically, and was another one of the predictable results of the decision the president made. You know, it's interesting what he made this point about guarding the border. Well, we've had troops on the border for 70 years in South Korea. really since the end of the Korean War, taking very few casualties, fortunately, but there to keep the peace. We've had troops in Europe, in Germany, there to keep the peace. And in fact, the Syrian group, the 1,000 or so special forces, took no combat casualties during this time, but did manage to keep an uneasy peace along that border. And that's traditionally been an American role. The president's got a legitimate argument to say that others should be taking that up, including the Europeans. But it's not as if this was a situation where the U.S. was taking significant casualties or spending very much money.
Exactly. It was a small number of troops in the scheme of things. David Sanger from Washington, good to have you with us. Barbara Starr at the Pentagon, thank you also.